Whenever I think about the biggest problem India has been facing since independence, and more particularly after we became a republic with a very profound constitution,
yes,
which talks about equality and justice and everything, but the persisting problem has been dehumanizing poverty of the vast masses of our people, and particularly the toiling masses,
yes,
those who work the hardest, they are the poorest,
yes,
the farmers and the laborers in general, Dalit and Adivasis, that's the social classification, women included, backwards, most backwards, etc., etc., and minorities who form part of this backward and other syndrome.
Yes.
Now, the question arises, how come India is home to the largest number of poorest of the poor in the world?
Yes.
And we are supposed to be fighting poverty, garibi hatao, and whatnot. And when Modi took over, I still remember his first speech, which was sort of a policy statement in the parliament. He said his biggest task would be to wipe out poverty. So Modi and all the other predecessors and all of our governments and their policies, they have failed miserably to wipe poverty at that level, the poorest of the poor level. And there is unemployment, and even with this Manrega and Asha and Anganwadi and other government schemes, we find hardly much of a change in eradicating poverty. Now, whenever I look into this whole question, and then I look into the whole sort of a crusade we had against the bonded labor system. The bonded labor system is considered to be the modern day slavery, and which includes child bonded labor or child slavery. Now, India is again home to the largest number of modern day slaves. Now, while defining this modern day slavery and bonded labor system, the Supreme Court in its landmark judgment in Bandhua Mukti Morcha versus Union of India and others in 1983 said that whoever is being denied minimum wage, even if that person is working voluntarily, seemingly voluntary, that person should be considered, the court will raise the presumption that he, she is a bonded labor. Now, if you apply this particular criteria to 500 million unorganized sector labor in our country, all governments, UPA and NDA, they all agree upon this figure, 500 million of our labor force, which constitutes nearly 93% of our labor force. Hardly 7% is in the organized sector. The remaining 93% is unorganized. And their numbers are 500 million.
Roughly half the population.
Nearly half the population. Their contribution, because of their hard work, to GDP is around 45% to 65%. That was the conclusion what Arjun Sen Gupta Commission,
yes,
came to when that commission was submitting its report to the then government of Dr. Manmohan Singh. In spite of all of that, we find the sorry state of affairs, the plight of the poor, the voiceless, is not being heard in the corridors of power, where all sorts of other tycoons and other racketeers, they are dominating. Now, in view of this, whenever we talk about raising the minimum wage or at least having some rational criteria for a national minimum wage,
yes,
then everybody, you know, starts crying foul. How can you have national minimum wage? How can you say that less than minimum wage is bonded labor, this and that, modern day slavery? They just like to pounce upon me and my colleagues.
Yes.
This is ridiculous. This is ridiculous. I have not said this definition. It is the highest judiciary of the land. And it's in consonance with the Bonded Labor System Abolition Act of 1976. It's nothing that they have done it arbitrarily. No. It's in consonance with that. Because the law defines who is a bonded laborer. They say anyone who is being forced to labor at a nominal wage. And what is a nominal wage? Anything less than statutorily fixed minimum wage is a nominal wage. And therefore, now in our country, the states have been fixing minimum wages arbitrarily here, there, and increasing it in 3, 4, 5 years' time, very nominal increase because of inflation, etc. And the criteria they had adopted for fixing minimum wage is how much calories a laborer requires in the urban setting or in a rural setting. Accordingly, how much food will be enough.
Yes, yes.
So it's like giving fodder to an animal so that the animal can survive and work.
That's I can tell you a very simple reason why the national minimum wage will not be implemented universally through the country and why it will be kept at the rock bottom where people will have to live like animals. I'll give you one example. Malaya,
Vijay Malaya
needs 17 lakhs of rupees
per
month to maintain his cars. Just one item. How much do you spend on maintaining your car?
My goodness.
This official figure submitted to the court in London, right? I need 17 lakhs to maintain my cars. All right. Now, you look at the lifestyle of any of these corporate tycoons whom we consider modern day gods.
Yes.
They are eating up resources worse than whales.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Their lifestyle is so obscenely lavish.
Yes.
There's no way this can be
the filthy rich.
There's no way this can be justified under any logic in the world.
Yeah.
And yet this is the pride of the society. Therefore, in a country of 1 billion and 300 million people, we are producing billionaires at the expense of billions of people.
Yes.
Now, I am afraid this is being done through banks. And I think
yes.
this is the greatest issue that needs to be addressed
yes.
because the common man is unaware of it. The banking system in this country has become a means for converting private wealth into corporate wealth.
Yeah.
Your money, my money, earned through a lifetime of hard and devoted work, entrusted to banks, is being quietly put into the large, deep pockets of these corporates. And I remember the Prime Minister making a statement in the Parliament of India quite recently, which is reported by the media, that the non-performing assets today stand at 52.5 lakh crores.
My goodness.
Now, to get an idea about what this means, the last budget of the Union Government was only 24 lakh crores. So the total
is more than double of
budget for 1.3 billion people, 130 crores of people, is owned by, is taken away from the banks by a few thousand people.
Yes.
And the top ones, there are people who owe to banks above 1 lakh crores.
The Ambanis and others.
Ambanis and others. But why is it that nobody asks them a question?
Yeah.
I want to ask another question. If a farmer borrows 5,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees and does not return it, it is never called non-performing assets. It's always called debt.
Debt, and then they are harassed, humiliated,
and they have
to the extent they have to commit suicide.
Now, why is it that thousands and thousands of crores of rupees borrowed by these big players who are rich, stinking rich, and whose lifestyle is an insult to common man's intelligence, That is called non-performing assets. Whose assets?
Recently there was a story in the newspaper.
Yes.
A poor farmer.
Yes.
In Uttar Pradesh near Kanpur.
Yes.
He borrowed about 5 lakh rupees to buy a tractor.
Yes.
He repaid 4,50,000 rupees.
Yes.
Only remaining was
50,000 rupees.
Yes. The bank sent its goons to realize that 50,000 rupees.
Yes, yes.
And these goons went and got onto that tractor.
Mm. Mm.
And then they beat him up and crushed him to death. For not paying that remaining 50,000.
Yeah, yeah.
This is the plight of the poor farmer, yeah, laborer in, yes, this country.
Yeah.
Now,
see, that
on the other hand, as you said, 52.5 lakh crores rupees simply being written off.
Given away. Charity.
Given away. Charity.
Charity to the richest
NPA,
in this country.
NPA, non-performing
assets.
Swamiji,
there is an aspect to this which everybody must understand.
Yes.
Now, I'm a retired person.
Yes.
My only income is from what little deposits I have with the banks.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Now, if that money is taken away from me, which according to the new bill which is before the Select Committee of the Parliament, that bill, if it is made into law, enables banks to take my money and to recapitalize itself. Right. Suppose I've kept 20 lakhs, right? I'm entitled to only 1 lakh, and the 19 lakh I have given to them can just disappear into thin air. Now, I'm a retired man, I have no other income.
Yes.
My health is poor, I need money, my wife needs treatment, there are regular expenses. I will be in the streets tomorrow. Now, why is it that the media in this country is not talking about it? Why is it that the opposition parties are not talking about it? Why is it that there is a deadly silence on this most dangerous issue which concerns everyone?
Yeah.
In fact, the middle class in this country are going to become paupers and beggars if this bill goes through and if this non-performing assets are not handled properly. I respected the Prime Minister because he came with a definite promise that he will eradicate black money. Now, there is a direct connection between non-performing assets and black money.
Mm.
All the non-performing assets are moving into the black money sector. So actually black money is being generated even today regularly, big time.
Yes.
Where has the Prime Minister's promise gone that he will eradicate black money? Okay, he may not be able to bring back the black money stashed abroad to the tune of 90 lakh crores. I think that's much more than what the British have ever taken out of this country.
Okay?
Oh, he will not be able to bring it, though he made big promises about it. Certainly he can do something about realizing the money stolen from our banks, from my money, your money,
yeah,
and save us from destitution, beggary and desperation and suicide. People are going to commit suicide, I can tell you this.
3.5 lakh farmers have already committed
suicide.
It's like a genocide.
Yeah, and nobody is bothered about it.
Yes.
And I think, first of all, there is no awareness about the magnitude of the problem. The media is deliberately quiet about it.
It's robbery, it's loot, it's,
yes,
a plunder.
It is murder. It is murder.
Yeah, murder. Broad daylight murder.
Yes.
Yes, you are right.
All that I have and worked for.
In addition to what you said, Dr. Valson, this Prime Minister,
yes,
very, you know, loudly declared that he is going to open crores and crores of zero balance bank accounts.
Yes, yes.
The poorest of the poor, who could never dream of having a bank account,
yes,
he claims that 31 crore new zero balance accounts have been opened.
Yes.
The other day, the Indian Express carried a front page report,
yes,
saying that State Bank of India alone,
yes,
Sort of find those zero balance accounts, account holders,
yes,
because their total deposit was less than 5,000 rupees.
Yes.
See, they say, we are maintaining your account, but you don't have money enough. So you better pay 500, 700 rupees fine. In this way, SBI collected more than 1,700 crore
yes,
rupees
right,
as fine. Now, see, the poor are first sort of told to have a zero balance account.
The poor are decoyed into the banking system. And robbed there.
Now this is the immorality of the highest order.
Yeah.
This is something which is really.
I believe, Swamiji, that non-performing assets is an issue on which the Supreme Court of India needs to initiate suo motu action, because there is a massive breach of trust. I handed over my money to the bank in trust. And moreover, the government, through successive legislations, makes it impossible for me to keep even a little of my private wealth with me in cash or gold, because all kinds of legislations are brought about to tie my hands. I have no option but to hand over the money. It is actually like holding somebody at gunpoint on the highway and demanding all that he has. Give me your purse or your life. It is that kind of a situation. And therefore, I remember the most expressive phrase used by the former Prime Minister, Sri Manmohan Singh, says, organize loot and legalize plunder. And that is exactly what is happening, going on.
Yeah.
And it's high time that the people of this country realized that their future is at stake, the future of their children is at stake. This is not a party matter. I have no truck and traffic with any party. I have to say that the Congress is as much to blame for this misery and this terror, economic terror to which we are sunk today, as the BJP. And I would also say that through their silence and complicity, all opposition parties, including the left, I would have expected the left parties to address this issue, because this is the issue of the common man.
Taken up this, up front, and this should have been their biggest
This is the issue of justice.
Yes.
This is the issue of the rights of the citizen.
Yes.
Now, everybody is quiet.
Now we have to take it up on a big way, and we will sort of organize seminars, meetings, and also some way so that the voice of the voiceless could be heard across the corridors of power and the judiciary also. And we will not wait for the Supreme Court to make a suo motu cognizance of this problem. We'll do something about
it. No, I wonder how long the country can go on like this.
Yeah.
I mean, going by whatever I have read, it seems to me, I could be, I'm not an economist, it seems to me that we are becoming a bubble.
Yes.
1.3 billion people, what will happen to them? All the people who have money will run away from here.
Yeah.
And there's an unofficial report saying that since 2014, 23,000 millionaires have fled from this country.
It's not just 23,000.
It is not just one Vijay Mallya or Lalit Modi or Choksi or Nirav Modi. Yeah. 23 million people have fled from this country with a lot of wealth.
And then 23,000. 23,000. Yeah.
And that's not their hard-earned money. This is the money they have looted from others. Right? Now, there nobody talks about these things. What is happening? What is happening to this country? So,
yes, Arun Jaitley and Narendra Modi combined, they are up for total disaster. I don't know.
That's very, very unfortunate.
And the poor are feeling helpless.
Swamiji, I will not blame both of them alone. I would blame all political parties.
Yes,
because,
because
what is the function of the opposition parties?
No,
is it
but let me ask you. I mean, if the government of the day knows that these other political parties who are not in power are also responsible, why don't they take action against them? Why don't they put them in jail? If they are not doing it, that means there is a total complicity.
That's right.
Yes.
There is something called the solidarity of corruption.
Corruption.
Understand?
Yes.
So they will support each other. For example, Modi promised that all corrupt people will be behind bars in 100 days.
Yes.
Not one person
Not one person.
Because they all support each other.
Not one among these most corrupt has ever committed suicide.
That's right.
Not one.
And lakhs have committed suicide because of them. If others are willing to commit suicide for them, why would they commit suicide? They're not fools. They're very smart people.
As you rightly said, these are not the farmers and others. They are not suicide. They are murders,
This is cold-blooded murder. This is systemic murder. And there is blood on the face of all these people whom we look up to as leaders.
Yes.
People have to realize that.